And I'm going to have two small presentations, two lightning talks, about 5 minutes each. The first about a button, which we call the RA21 button, and the next about something we call Grand Unified IdP. And this is actually the what I'm going to show today. This is the button to the right of you on the top of the screen. And it is an attempt to standardize how you do what's called discovery in a SAML connected world. And I will just make two small demonstrations and then we can talk about what was the problem in the first place. So this is a Wave test service. I have two test services, Wave SP and Wave SP2. And I haven't had time to change the color, so they look quite the same, but you have to believe me when I say we are using one or we're using the other one. So this is Wave SP2. So if we want to log in here, we click this button here. Sorry, this is a mistake. This is the next presentation. We need to do this. Just start over. If I want to log in using my university account, I just click here. And then I see what's called a transparency page. And normally you only see this once during the whole thing. But this SP2 is set up to show it every time. So we will see it every time we log into this. And this SP has no concept of a session or anything. It just dumps all this, all the attributes and actually the whole SAML thing below, so you can see what's going on. But the idea is that you logged into this service, and it was seamless, so to speak. So if we go to the next service, and believe me, this is another one. This is the Wave SP, and you can do the same here. You click on this button and you're actually just logged in because I already had single sign on DTU. But what if we get to a kind of a blank browser with no previous thing in the local storage? We will have this button there, log into your institution. So we will do the same thing now. This is Wave SP2 in a kind of it's not a private window. It is kind of a new I can't recall what the case. You can see there's a blue, small blue stripe. It is a new context, or so to say, in Firefox. So when we if you haven't chosen any SP previously, we will see the traditional what's called the Wave. That's why we are called Wave as well. The traditional discovery service. This is a Wave discovery service. In my view, it is one of the best out there, actually. Not because I made it, but because it is actually quite good. And we will select DTU. And we will log into DTU. And we will see this transparency thing. And then you can see we will have the same information here. And we will be ready to use DTU again to log in the next time. But what if we then went to an SP that we hadn't visited before, like this one? This is, you have to believe me again, this is the Wave SP, but it already knows about the DTU IDP, so we can just click on this page again and log in to using DTU. And again, we will see this page because this is actually the very first time we use these attributes for this SP. So now we are logged in. So that was kind of the solution, and I guess you all think this is extremely boring because that's what the idea about this. And that is actually the whole idea, that this is meant to be boring because it is meant to be easy and a no-brainer for everyone to do. So the idea is actually that instead of having each SP deciding on their own how to do this discovery thing, how to save which IDP they're going to use, we're going to standardize on this button. It has to be on the front page of the SP, and it has to have this look. I guess you are able to actually change the color without misusing the recommendation, but that's the idea. So it is meant to be boring. And it comes from this organization called RA21. And they have made this recommendation for improved access to institutional provided information resources. RA21 is resource access in the 21st century. And this is a group of librarians and publishers that got together and said, in the future, we can't use IP numbers as the access control list anymore for scientific content. It is still being used to this day. Right? And they looked around and they said, what could we use instead? And they said, oh, federated access. Which problems could there be in federated access? And they found out that this discovery process actually was kind of difficult because every SP made their own version of it. And the user were confused, got confused. So they standardized on this on this button. And this is some places where you can get more information. RA21 is where the original report comes from. This IO is where they keep the code behind this one. And seamless.org is kind of a new global domain for saving what the user actually uses. I must admit that the code behind this one was far too complicated for me to understand, so I wrote my own version of what is actually going on, so we don't see any of this IO code in behind this one. And the current implementation has, in my view, a problem that it only allows you to have one IDP at a time. And at least in Denmark, and I will see you in the next presentation, we have the need to distinguish which IDP you use for different SPs. So you have to remember the pairs and not just one IDP. The technical thing behind it is an iframe and some HTML and JavaScript from a common domain, and the common domain would be seamless.org. And then some post messages. It is meant to be kind of pluggable. You can plug in your own discovery service into this. And I guess they have to be authenticated or authorized to do that. So they have some kind of what's called post message JavaScript communication between the iframe and the frame the discovery service that puts things into the actual local storage. So this was the button. Any questions or comments or Peter?
Yeah. Yes. This is technically wise, it is a good solution. I totally agree with you. Maybe one should know that this is that this comes. This doesn't work. But my voice is loud enough, I think. This comes from the publisher community. RA21 was a publisher. Publishers of research information, commercial publishers, and there's one problem in this solution that you create data on a centralized service, and there is the fear that publishers will use such information about who went to which service when.
But I do not agree that you save anything centrally in this case. The HTML and the JavaScript is hosted on a CDN under the seamless.org domain, but everything you save is saved on your local machine, actually. So you're using, it is using local storage for actually remembering the IDPs and the things.
It is
privacy preserving. In I only have 5 minutes in all. Though. Okay, thank you. Yeah, we can discuss it. But it's privacy preserving. Even though you can see the name of the IDP on an on the button on an SP you have never visited before, the SP is not able to see the IDP actually. The next 5 minutes lightning talk is called the Grand Unified IDP, and it is we call it that because the real name is actually the guest user IDP, but it sounds more interesting to call it the Grand Unified IDP. And it is a project we have working on in WAVE, and it tries to solve the problem about guest users for federated SPs. How do we do that? Normally you register a guest, give them a new username and password, and then you have, as an SP, you have at least two ways to log them in, the SAML one, the federated one, and then a login username password thing. And for the user, this is a disadvantage as well, because they have yet another username password to keep track of. So our idea was to split the user information from the authentication, and have an IDP that only gave back to the SP what the SP itself has put into the IDP in the first place. And that would make it possible for the SP only to have one login method, namely the federated one, and the guest user would then have a single sign-on, even if she or he was guest user multiple SPs. We ended up with an architecture that looks like this. We call it SP1 here. And then we have the GUI DP here. And the SP1 starts by telling the GUI DP, this is an SP in the sense that it is a service, but it's also an SP in the sense that we already have metadata for it in the metadata for the federation, so we know it's public key. So it can send us a HTTP request, a signed HTTP request, and tell us where it has its user database. So we have a database here, and it tells the UDP that the SP1 database is the UDP1 here, where it keeps its users. And we have devised, it's a very simple, just a normal GET protocol for actually getting user data out of it. The user then, the SP then registers a new user, gives them a username, and tells on another endpoint, the GUIDP, this is now user ABC at my domain. Please give me a token I can give to the user. So the GUIDP returns a token, T1 we can call it, and that to the user. The way the token is delivered to the user depends on the requirements the SP has to identity proofing of the actual user. This is totally up to the SP in this case. It can be by mail if it's a low level assurance, or it can be by personal meeting if they have a high level requirements for actually knowing who the user is. But the idea is that the user then presents this to the GUIDP and is asked to select a backend IDP. The reason it was a guest user in the first place was that they didn't have an account at the IDP. So maybe it would be an IDP of a last resort. Maybe Sparrow could be a solution for that. Maybe some of the just register at an IDP things. We actually don't need to know who the user is. The important thing is that they have an what we call a federation ID. It's also called a targeted ID, but you know this pairwise ID. So we can recognize the user next time they come by. I don't have time to demonstrate it then, but the idea is that the user then registers this one, and then they can log in using this backend IDP to the service. and the service gets back what it has already saved here. This is not a big deal when it's only one SP, but what if the SPs start to trust each other as IDPs actually? So this SP can see I trust another SP as a good enough to be IDP for me as well. So maybe an SP ends up not being actually an SP, but a kind of an IDP for more than one SP. So we have a community of SPs that trust one SP. Then we call it a virtual organization. No more time. Thank you.